Welcome to the Seller Roundtable e-commerce coaching and business strategies with Andy Arnott and Amy Wees.
And you gave me an example of the upsells and the follow-ups that were being done on your email follow-ups. And you were saying that you also want to look at your upsells and your add-ons and really target them to the customer. I think you gave me an example of somebody was selling a really expensive item and they were giving away like a $1 journal or something.
Yes. 100%. I know exactly what you're talking about. Yes. So what I was saying was, is when you're building a landing page, right? When you're building, let's say an acquisition page, like we just talked about, you want to have, we use those as entry points for segmentation, right? We know that people who entered this land through this landing page probably ascribe to this kind of message and this, they're probably follow this audience, right? So what we do is we make sure that the offers and the post-purchase offers, the messaging, everything we develop for that customer is catered to that customer. Our offers on the back end, if somebody, you know, let's say you're selling a supplement, right? If you sold maybe a higher quality, higher priced protein powder, you probably don't want to go and have a shaker bottle at the, you know, as your main upsell 7 days down the road. You know, you don't want to have a generic post-purchase process. You want to make sure that everybody is kind of getting their own respective message, right? So that it resonates with them. Because when you try and sell to everybody, you sell to nobody, you know? So right. it's really about making sure that, and this is like, it's just really about being considerate, I think about. When you think about, like, think about somebody coming into your actual store, right? Imagine somebody, you own a storefront and you have somebody that comes in and they buy something and then they make this purchase and then you take them to some other completely area of the store and try and sell them stuff over there that has nothing to do with what they just purchased, right? Like somebody comes to buy floral stuff from Home Depot and you go take them to the saws and hammers, right? It doesn't make sense, right? We don't think of it like that because we're in the digital space sometimes, but it's really that simplistic when you think about it. Like sell people what they want to be sold, not what you want to sell them, right? And that's a big thing that like a lot of people, like it's not what you want to sell, it's what people want to buy.
And I loved how you did, you know, you took, and this is a great idea for all of you listeners out there. You know, you took a single supplement and you presented it with three or four different landing pages, same supplement, but this one was for hiking.
Yep.
And it was like the hiking supplement. You were really speaking to the hiker, right? And then this one over here was for like the hardcore bodybuilder, right?
100%.
And so you're not going to try and sell the hardcore bodybuilder accessories to the hiker, you know, who's more interested in endurance and everything like that. So I love, and any one of us could practice that with any of our products. We could create multiple landing pages with different messages that are targeted towards different types of customers and customers who are on different journeys in their lives, right? And we can, or we could look at all the pain points that our customers have and have a landing page for each pain point, right? And then and then your follow-up messages also continue to target that same customer. So you not only built multiple landing pages, but you also built multiple follow-up sequences that were personalized for that customer. So I just think that is just so smart. And then by the time you're done, what you've done is you've basically built out this whole infrastructure of where, you know, they can plug in their next products and they kind of know the process for that. So that's just awesome. I love that you do that. And I think that it's a great tip for all of our listeners to sell your product to multiple different customers, but make sure that you're targeting them separately and not trying to, hey, if you're a hiker, a biker, or a hardcore weightlifter, like this is for everyone.
Yeah, and that was one thing I didn't mention. I don't think I touched on enough in the research process is, you know, learn who your customer is, you know, go into forums, go into, you know, anywhere where your customers are discussing things, Facebook groups, like just go in there. You don't have to, you know, you're not there to spam anybody. You're just there to read and just consume. You know, Amy, I think I told you, I spend more time at Amazon events than I do Shopify events because I'm trying to learn my customer. I'm trying to learn like, what are the pain points that they have? What are the challenges? That's how I've learned all the things that I can go back and forth with you on and what I'm hearing, because I'm hearing it from actual sellers. So that's one thing, is just really go deep on learning who your customers and how to speak to them. We have a section in our discovery sheet. It's called vernacular. Like, what are words that they use that these people specifically use? Because if you don't speak like them, you know, you can't sell to them. Right. So that was just one thing to you know, use. And then one last tip that we use on landing pages, because this is really good in relation to what you said about how messaging changes, right? Think of it like this. When we sell a product, right, we don't want to just compare things for the purpose of comparison. So I'm talking about comparison charts, right? So with comparison charts, most people think that you're comparing features and benefits, right? You're just comparing the two. But what we found, comparison charts are actually very powerful for product and market positioning. So what I mean by that is, let's say, you know, I have my protein brand, right? So let's say I want to position my product and my messaging when I'm messaging to somebody, whoever that audience is. If I have a comparison chart and I want to message somebody who does like plant-based protein, like Vega, Sun Warrior, all these great brands, you know, that we compete against, right? Then that's what, but what if I want to brand my product as a breakfast product, right? Like, what if I have a landing page with a breakfast product? Now I'm not comparing to them. Now I'm comparing to Ensure, Our Nation, SlimFast, right? Now I've subliminally, but also explicitly placed my product in a specific place where my customer can understand what it is, right? So when you build, use comparison charts, because they don't just set out features and benefits, and you know, you can use those features and benefits, but use them in relation to what the market is talking about in that segment. You know, if you're going to compare a latte product to another latte, compare it to Starbucks and, you know, Dunkin' Donuts. And, you know, if you're doing a healthier product, something like that, just that I know that it makes a huge difference on our pages is comparison charts. So that would be one last tip.
I love that. And I mean, that ties back into that replacement, right? Like, what are you replacing?
What are you replacing? Yeah, it makes it explicit.
Love it.
Explicit.
So let's get back to basics. I mean, you do such an amazing job building out Shopify. You're building out monster sites and really helping people through every area of the funnel. What you're doing is very, very on a very professional level. So yeah, let's get back to basics for those brands that are just starting out and considering Shopify.
Sure.
What do you think about Shopify in terms of, like, when should I have more than just a placeholder page for my brand? Like, when do I start throwing some eggs into the Shopify basket?
Great question. So I think I think that really is, I think it's kind of universal when it comes, the answer to that is kind of universal when it comes to a lot of the sales channels that we work with, right? So I always tell people, if you're selling, let's say you get a guy like me, when, before I, you know, got involved in the Amazon to Shopify space, I was selling on Shopify, right? I'm selling on Shopify and I'm running traffic from Facebook, and Facebook is doing okay. It's not doing stellar. But I haven't given up on it yet. Right. I probably don't want to go and take capital from there and allocate it to another traffic source to then do another mediocre job with another traffic source. I want to master this source first, right? Like, my Facebook acquisition is doing very well. My CPAs are healthy. My traffic isn't super expensive, which is hard in, you know, these days with Facebook, but nonetheless, it's converting at a very efficient level. I can sustain this, right? When I hit that level, that's when I'm willing to pivot, you know, in traffic sources. If I want to go and run traffic from YouTube and Google, you better believe that my Facebook and Instagram traffic is either, I'm either using it or I'm not using it. Sorry, my phone went off. I'm either using it or I'm not using it, right? So if I'm using Facebook, I'm going all in. If I'm not using, then I'll go somewhere else. So it's kind of up to, you know, an Amazon seller when it comes to that. Have you really gotten to where you feel like you have a good grasp on customer acquisition? You know, how much are people purchasing your product? What are your sales monthly? Do you feel that you're doing, I guess we never all have it figured out, right? Like, if we all had it figured out, we probably wouldn't be listening to podcasts, right? So we're always trying to learn, but I do feel like there's a certain point where we understand, like, hey, okay, I'm ready to make this transition. I'm ready to go horizontal into another traffic source and allocate revenue there, because that is another thing. In order to get data, you have to spend money, and you're going to need data. Go ahead.
And that's the same thing that I tell people about just moving to other channels or expanding internationally on Amazon. It's like, okay, well, do you have where your primary sales channels are right now? Do you have that figured out? Like, are you understanding how much money you're making, what your turnover is, how to stay in stock, your logistics, like all of those things? Like, it's good to have a good system built for that before all of a sudden, because every new channel you move into, and Shopify is no different, especially when you want to sell on your own website, you are driving the traffic now. Right. And so you got to go bring traffic to your page. So before you, it's not a set it and forget it kind of thing, nor is Amazon, nor is Walmart, nor any of the channels. So we really do have to take the time to kind of get to know our channels and make sure that we're profitable, we're scalable. And then when we know we're profitable and we're scalable, we go, okay, well, let's look at Shopify, or let's look at adding Walmart, or let's look at adding an international Amazon, you know, channel. Whatever it is, like, focus on the one thing at a time. And back to your comparison chart, Marsha has a question. She said, what if there are very few comparable products? So what if it's a new, never seen before product, or there's very few comparable products? Do you have a tip there?
So let me ask you, so do you have anything that you're replacing currently? Like, is there a product that we're replacing?
Yes. I believe so. With her product, there are, because she is replacing the need for things like hand sanitizer and stuff like that. So
I would probably put, like, whatever I can replace, I would probably, like, you and I just, you called it out right away. Like, well, usually what you're replacing or what you're improving upon is going to be in that comparison chart. So if you're going to, even though it might not be hand sanitizer, right? You might not even be selling hand sanitizer. That's okay, because you're just giving it in, you're putting it in a position for the consumer saying, okay, I don't need hand sanitizer anymore because I have this product. And here's why it's better, right? The better is like the bonus. The better is the actual comparison part of the comparison chart is the cherry on top. What it really does, it shows the consumer what they're replacing, and then it tells them why they're replacing it.
And when I think about Marsha's product, I think not only does it replace the need for things like hand sanitizer, it also replaced the need for a lot of health supplements that you might be taking to constantly stay healthy, because, you know, so you can say, like, look at all these things you can throw. You think of that old As Seen on TV commercials, like, throw that in the trash.
I always say there's a little bit of As Seen on TV in, like, you know, Facebook advertising and, you know, like, using special acquisition offers, but wait, there's more kind of deal with upsells. You just got to make it kind of classy, right? You got to make it, it's got to be tasteful. It can't be like too salesy, or else you get really deep into, like, the, you know, kind of like pushy salesman tactic.
Got it. Okay. So let's talk about comparison sales now, as far as websites, web platforms go. Tell me about, what do you like about Shopify versus other e-commerce platforms like WooCommerce, for example?
Sure. Yeah. Well, I when I first started getting into e-commerce, I was building on WooCommerce and WordPress. So I wasn't building, but I was hiring people to build on. So I'm pretty familiar with the platform, and I don't have anything against it, right? Like, I think it's a good platform. We build, you know, some of the business owners that we work with, they do have a WooCommerce site and they want to stay there. So it has its advantages. One of the things that I really like about Shopify is just the ease of use. You know, it's got apps, you know, it does, you know, some of these apps, they can get a little, you know, just being a fair comparison, they can get a little costly. You know, they add up after you know, have 10 different apps that you're using, but just the fact that it's so easy to use, you know, it syncs, everything just links right up to it.
Yeah,
I love
how the dashboard is just so seamless.
The dashboard is great.
You know, you can, like, look at your Facebook ads and your conversions and everything from your Shopify dashboard, which I was like, wow. You know, we did a Shopify course in our mastermind group, and it really made me want to switch from e-commerce to Shopify, because I was like, but then you've got the nickel and diming, right? Where it's like, oh, one more app. Oh, let now our monthly costs are up to hundreds of thousands of dollars, right?
Yeah, you're spending a couple, you can spend, you know, a couple, it's not hard to get to a couple thousand. I mean, it's not, you have to be doing volume at that point. I wouldn't think that, you know, a smaller store is doing a couple thousand dollars in fees. But, you know, a couple $100 is not unreasonable if you've got a couple of pretty decent apps that are really important, you know?
Right. I love that comparison though.
Yeah. It's just an easier platform, in my opinion. Like you said, the metrics, you can plug it. There's a lot of really good apps that work with, like, lifetime value. There's a company called Lifetimely. I'm going to give them some free promo here, but they're it's a great app. Gives you lots of LTV information about your customer. We use it on all of our projects, dashboards, data source. You know, there's a lot of cool things you can do on Shopify. It's cooler.
Yes, it's better for the
just
nerds.
Cooler, I guess.
I like it.
Yeah, right. You're right.
Well, Caulen, I would love to talk a little bit more about, you know, because the last time I talked to you, we were talking about what you do for brands. So your company takes on certain brands and you basically grow out their Shopify channel for them. Sure. And it's not like a, I wouldn't say it's not like you're not like building someone's first Shopify site. People are not coming to you to build their first Shopify site. What you're doing is taking brands that are true private labels. They have a differentiated product. They have those four aspects that we talked about and that you can really build great funnels for, and you're building them an asset. You are doing the job for them and you're building them an asset. So talk about what kinds of brands that you work with, because I'm sure there are a lot of brands in our listener group that are thinking like, wow, I would love somebody to take over my Shopify manage it for me and grow it for me. But talk a little bit about the type of brands that you work with and what you guys do for them.
Totally. Yeah. So, well, you know, the first thing that we always do is whenever we bring on a new brand, the first thing we do is we meet with the founder and CEO, whoever's in charge there. We look at the product. We look at the product together. They'll send it to me, and I usually, if it's a smaller product, I usually just ask that it gets sent to me so I can try and use it. You know, if it's something that I can use, if it's a house product or a food product or something, I always like to touch, feel, see, and get an experience for what the product looks like. So we typically work with consumer packaged goods, lots of CPGs. We're very familiar with supplements. We have quite a few clients in the supplement space. I also really like to work with problem solving products, like direct to consumer problem solving, something that solves big problems and desirable problems, people that definitely need these problems solved. That's something that we want to look for. More or less when we're looking at businesses, we're also taking into account not just new opportunities that exist on the product side, but what also can exist as a product or an industry authority side, right? Because there's some times where you'll find products that maybe aren't as unique, right? Like maybe you don't have something that's super, super unique, but what you do have is the opportunity of an opening in the market where there's no D2C authority, because there's a difference between a standard and an authority, right? Like you can have a company that sells a specific product and maybe people just use it because that's all there is there. But if there's no direct to consumer authority in the space, you actually have a new opportunity for the market, which is to claim that you are the authority and we are the go-to source. Because I'll do research, product research. When somebody gives me a product, I'll see where it's being sold, right? Is it only being sold through online distribution or online marketplaces? If it's only being sold on online, like people think that that's a bad thing. I actually think it's a good thing. Because that tells me there's nobody directly connecting with the customer. Like there's nobody who's directly saying like, this is a great opportunity for you to deal with the authority in the space. And we're going to be here for you when you need help, because you're going to need help. You can't go to Home Depot and, get everything that you can get directly from a brand. You can't get that closeness. So we look for that opportunity as well. Is there an opportunity to be an authority in the space? Is there anybody competing with you in the D2C space? So that's another thing that we look at. And then, obviously we look at, when it comes to just the brands that we work with and the relationships we like to build, because I think that's something that a lot of people, I don't want to say it's a challenge, but in e-commerce, there's definitely no shortage of like horror stories that people have heard, right? Like we've all heard them all, right? Like I worked with somebody and then they just like ran Facebook ads for me and they ran them into the ground. Like we've all heard it, right? So the number one thing that I always tell people when we work together is that we want you to understand that this is going to be you're investing in infrastructure first. So I always like to analogize it to a restaurant, right? If you wanted to open up a restaurant, right, after owning, maybe a nice profitable food truck, and you want to go and build a restaurant, right, you're going to have to pay for the restaurant. You're going to have to pay for the waiters. You're going to have to pay for the for the management. You're gonna have to pay for all that, and then you're gonna have to pay to market the business, right? So it has to be somebody who understands that this is not like, because you know, we don't want people to think that this is a get rich quick. Like we don't. That's not really how it works. This is somebody really wanting to invest in infrastructure, take their brand to the next level, and say, I want to build an asset for my business because eventually I'd like to, you know, go past, maybe they don't want to just do the aggregator thing with Amazon, right? They want to go and get acquired by a major brand. So, you know, that's now that becomes an asset because now you're collecting data. We like to work with people who understand like, hey, we're not saying you're not going to get results. We literally guarantee sales, but it's not at first we're getting data. We're getting your assets built and we're putting together the infrastructure you need to actually sell. So I think psychologically, one of the things we look for is just that preparedness to say, hey, I'm ready to go from point A to point B and I'm willing to build this. So good product, potential for being an authority in the space and the mindset that you're going to be investing in building an asset, not just building, you know, a piece of real estate on a marketplace, you know?
Right. Exactly. Yeah. I love that. Well, thank you for sharing that. Yeah. I'm down to my last two questions.
Nice. So nice.
From a business perspective and even a personal growth perspective, what are some things that you're reading, listening to, that kind of thing that keep you motivated?
Cool. So, I'm reading a book. I'm actually reading, and I don't want to sound like I'm like, you know, I'm reading three books, but I'm not like, I don't always do that. It's just like, that just happened recently that I got three books sent to me at the same time. So I'm reading this book called Influenced, which is just a really amazing book about B2B, you know, being a D2C, I've been selling D2C and, you know, selling direct to consumer. And then with the agency space, you get a little bit more involved in B2B. And it's just a great book about value, providing value and how you can use value as a true asset in business. And that's to me is like, my number one goal is to provide value to people before anything. So Influence, my business partner actually just gave me a book the other day called The Obstacle is the Way, which I'm reading currently. It's pretty decent. And other than that, you know, just constantly trying to push myself. Like I really am. Like I'm constantly trying to push to see what the next level looks like, you know, and see where I can get better, especially in like, you know, obviously as a parent, you know, I have kids and stuff, but, you know, professionally, I really like to push the threshold, you know, like how much better can I get, you know, and how much more can I learn? I'm always reading. I mean, we have something at the agency, ABL, always be learning. And we're literally like obsessed with learning. So that's kind of how I keep busy. And obviously, you know, personal life, you know, kids and gym and
And coming to see us at Prosper. So oh, we're going to oh, yeah, see you yeah. there. Prosper's so excited to see you again. I saw you in Miami, so it's good.
I know.
We'll be seeing you at Prosper and maybe a day of the Empowering Women's Conference. That'll be awesome.
Yeah.
So awesome. Well, the last thing is, how can people get in touch with you?
Oh, great. So yeah, very easy. Of course, my dog starts barking right when I go to tell people how they can get in touch with me. How funny is that? That's my life. Very easy. You can, actually the easiest way is through LinkedIn, cause I'm very active on LinkedIn. So you can look me up. You can spell my name, Caulen. I'm probably the only person on LinkedIn that I know of that probably has their name spelled like me. So that's one option. If you'd like to email me, my email is Caulen, Caulen at brainpower.agency. I think those are the two best ways to get in touch with me.
Love it. Okay. Well, thank you all for being here. Thank you for listening. Thank you, Caulen, for just dropping so many nuggets today.
Yeah.
And we've got a bunch of folks here in our Zoom chat. And so we're going to stop the recording and we're going to let our folks that are in our Zoom chat ask any questions that they have.
For sure.
And now we're going to stop the live as well. But we just want to remind you guys, first of all, thank you for listening. And I hear from so many of you and just love that you listen to us and that you get value out of what we bring. It's one of my favorite things to do all week is to record this podcast because I get to learn from amazing people like Caulen. So, you know, just please rate, review, subscribe, go to sellaroundtable.com and hit that subscribe button so that you get notified of all of our new episodes. And we just appreciate y'all so much. And we will see you next time on the Seller Roundtable. Goodbye, everyone.
Thanks for tuning in. Join us every Tuesday at 1 p.m. Pacific Standard Time for live Q&A and bonus content after the recording at sellerroundtable.com. Sponsored by the ultimate software tool for Amazon sales and growth, SellerSEO.com and AmazingAtHome.com.